Party.
I had too much to drink.
Anyway, have a great time tonight. It's meant to be a real fun party, so it's gonna go late. Alright, so Aaron, what's JB and I guess come for a little bit about the Gigafactory and just give you some sense of what we're aiming for here, what this means, what it means to the world, and I think it's something that's really gonna make a big difference. So, just going through the Tesla mission, obviously Tesla mission is to accelerate the transition to sustainable energy.
Yeah!
The world. It matters if it happens sooner or later. It matters if it happens at scale. And that's what the Gigafactory is about. It's about being able to make enough electric cars, enough stationary battery packs that it actually moves the needle from a global carbon production perspective. So that it actually does really change the world. So that's why it has to be big, because the world is big. The crazy thing is, what you're seeing here is actually only 14%. It's 1/7 of what the completed factory will be. But we've been able to increase the output of the factory compared to the original design by a factor of 3. So ultimately, we think that the factory will produce about 150 gigawatts. So we'll talk about that. Starting with what's needed for the Gigafactory is the Model 3. So this is really about being able to make enough cells, enough batteries to make hundreds of thousands, ultimately millions of electric cars, and to do so at a massive scale and in a way that is affordable to people. So it doesn't matter. Cars also need to be affordable, otherwise you can't buy them. So in order to achieve that, there are two key dimensions that are necessary. One is to keep iterating technology, design technology to be better and better, and have multiple versions, and so this would be our third major generation of technology, and then economies of scale. So we're driving those to the absolute maximum with the Gigafactory, and that's why it's so big. It's big for a reason. There wasn't enough factory capacity. There just wasn't enough factory capacity anywhere else in the world. We didn't have an option. This factory will have the output of all the lithium-ion factories combined when it's done. Yeah, exactly. The basic math was that in order to make a half million cars a year, we would need every lithium-ion battery on Earth that makes batteries for phones, laptops, cars, everything, just to achieve that output. So it's like, well, really that's not being built because you'd be able to see it on the satellite picture. So either we figure out some way to build this thing or there will not be the cars that are needed. So we kind of just said, okay, we're going to just start building this thing and hopefully people will buy into it and start to believe.
Change the world!
Thanks. We're going to be able to do this because of you guys. So it's without you, this could not be possible. So I just want to say thank you very much. To do this, we really had to design the factory as a machine.
So a lot of the way that people look at factories is kind of, it's up until it's kind of like a boring thing, like making photocopies or something. It's like boring, it's like catalog engineering. But this is totally wrong way to look at it. You really need to look at a factory like it's a product, like it's a giant machine that builds a machine. And it deserves actually more innovation and more engineering skill than the product itself. And that's what we've done with Gigafactory.
We have some of our best engineering teams working on actually laying out the factory and looking at how it would fit more density and more equipment into the same footprint. And this is really key to how we've been able to reduce the cost of the cells and the batteries that come out of here so much. You know, that intense engineering effort, you know, is what drives this improvement. It's not just, as Elon said, it's not a copying machine, it's not just, you know, replicating things that have been done before. We're reinventing that battery manufacturing process from end to end.
Yeah, in fact, I can't emphasize enough how important this conceptual framework is. Because really, almost everywhere, just think of a factory as a bunch of machines, like basic machines that are stuck together to produce copies. And it's mostly pulled from catalogs. You know, you can get this machine from that person, that company, this machine from another company. But if you apply that same principle to your product design, it wouldn't make any sense. Like, if we try to make the Model S out of parts from a bunch of different cars, it would be ridiculous. You know, it would be like, you know, bumper from a Honda, a steering wheel from this, motor from something else.
It would look like from Camry.
Right, exactly. It wouldn't make any sense to actually make a car from bits and pieces of other cars. You really need to design your car as an integrated product from the ground up. And that's the same approach we've taken to the Gigafactory. It's really quite unusual for that to be the case. And then in terms of analyzing how the factory should work, I'm really kind of using physics as an analytical framework for
physics.
Physics is true, everything else is available. And even physics is true. Designing the factory from physics first principles means really optimizing the density of the factory. So you can feel like the fundamental efficiency of the factory is the density of useful stuff. Like, what percent of the volume of the factory is actually useful stuff versus not useful stuff? And then the output of the factory is the exit velocity of products from the factory. So we're actually just applying that through every step of the process. We're actually pretty confident that there's at least maybe a 5 to 10-fold, at least 5, I think, and maybe 10-fold potential improvement in production capability. And this image you guys can see, maybe some of you can see on the screen, is an actual cab of the factory. You know, just like a great machine, the entire factory is in cab. You know, every pipe, every electrical conduit, every piece of software, and every piece of equipment building the cells. So, you know, we've modeled all that to fit it in, you know, with the minimum wasted space. Everything is basically almost touching each other on every floor. So, you know, that was necessary to build this amazing machine. And many factories aren't done this way. You build a shell and then you sort of randomly put equipment in there. But this is very different. Yeah, it's essentially designed like a very high density, multi-layer integrated circuit, like an advanced CPU, which is really, and actually when you think about it, it's like obviously how it should be done. And I think actually over time, the manufacturing process may look a lot like one of those super fast chip pick and place machines. It's super optimized for speed and density. I mean, you think about how did we improve the capability of your phone or your laptop? It wasn't by making a really giant computer the size of a table. It was by increasing the clock speed and the density. And those same principles apply to manufacturing. So I'm really excited about revitalizing manufacturing. I think it's sort of, it needs love, and we're going to give it.
Yeah!
And we're also expanding the scope of what people typically thought of as a battery factory. You know, we're going all the way from the basic raw materials that go into making up the cell, you know, all the way through to the finished battery packs and under one roof in a single factory. You know, it's historically, it's going to be through a lot of different factories.
It's a three-step process. We got all our secrets are right here. Raw material, a bunch of stuff happens, out into the car. The vertical integration is pretty important because one way to think of manufacturing efficiency is how long a journey did that molecule take from when it was mined. So if it was mined in one part of the world, then went halfway across the world to get processed, then back halfway across the world to get processed another way, and eventually there's several trips around the world before it finally ends up in a finished product. That's obviously just a that's fundamentally going to be expensive. Just can't send things on round the world trips and expect them to be cheap. It's more affordable. It's just not going to happen. So it makes sense ultimately for rail cars or raw materials to come in one side, and then for finished vehicles to actually be in the other side. So today we get sort of split up. We've got the vehicle factory in Fremont, California. We've got the battery factory here in Nevada. I think for Gigafactory 2 and beyond, I think we're just going to integrate that into one big facility. Just to give you a sense of scale, you know, I think you guys have seen the models, normally as many of you have gone on tours, but to make it sort of more, you know, more real, you know, this factory is going to be about 6 million square feet of ground area.
That's actually the footprint.
Yeah,
just a footprint.
It'll be the biggest building in the world, biggest single building in the world by footprint, and second only in volume to the Boeing factory in Washington State.
It's really, really huge. And if you also think of, you know, something that maybe you're familiar with, like a 747, that's pretty big, right? We can fit about 100 747s parked in the footprint of this building.
Yeah, and, I mean, not only that, we can fit 50 billion hamsters.
Throughout
the world was only about 30 gigawatt hours. Okay, so this is more than the entire plant produced last year in 2014. Maybe it was slightly more last year, but still pull it. I figure roughly this one factory will produce as much as the rest of the world combined.
Yes!
And then as we get a couple years later, past 2020 or thereabouts, we expect when the factory is fully built out. And like I said, you're actually standing, where you are right now is the middle of the factory. You're standing in the middle of where the factory will be, but it's complete.
I'm not surprised.
So, we're shutting on the party, I think. We figure out that should be able to do on order of 1.5 million cars, and also provide a lot of power for station storage for battery banks, which are obviously very important to pair with solar.
And all this is happening a lot faster than we even initially planned it could. And with the amazing results from Model 3, you know, we've pulled ahead of that 500,000 cars by fully 2 years. So the building you see outside is almost doubling in scope. You're just by next year in order to build those 500,000 Model 3s per year.
Yeah. So, I'm not sure if people got the, not many people got the hot shot score good part. People saw that very good.
It's a secret, Master Jam, right?
It's a top secret.
Yeah.
So really, there's four parts to it, which is to make beautiful solar combined with battery storage, to expand to one of the major vehicle segments in order to, as quickly as possible, move us away from oil. And get to a self-driving capability that's about 10 times better than the average driver. So that's a lot of lives saved. So 1.2 million people die a year in auto accidents, so that's a lot of potential for life saving there. The ability to add your car to a shared fleet whenever you want. So whenever you're not using your car, you'll just tap the Tesla app on your phone and add it or subtract it to the shared fleet.
Yeah.
You'll be able to define who can use it, like only 5-star users or anyone or family or whatever. And then whatever you want back, you just tap it and it will return to you. This has the potential to massively amplify the utility of vehicles and also the cost of
ownership. Yes!
We call that to you when you want to do it or not do it. It's yours.
Will it find Pokemon for us?
It will find Pokemon for you.
And as we said earlier, a lot of people really doubted that there would be enough demand to even make a factory like this make sense in this time frame. And we started this way before the Model 3 launch event, before we had all those reservations. And I think it's really a tribute to all of you guys as customers that are making this possible. So we'll thank all of you for doing this.
That's basically an overview of the Gigafactory what we're up to. I don't know, we could maybe take a few questions.
Yes!
How many people work at the factory?
Right now we have about 1,000 people working on site. With the expansion to 150 gigawatt hours, we expect there will be some sort of efficiency that's gained, but it's still probably only over 10,000 people working on that.
All the power walls and power packs that we're sending out are good right here today, so that's operational and good.
Oh yeah, so recycling, good point, I should mention. So we actually will have recycling at the Gigafactory itself. So all battery packs will be recycled, which actually makes a lot of sense. Because this is a real efficient way to recycle it, because we know what the module looks like. So we can actually design recycling machines that are exactly optimized for the battery pack, because we're not trying to recycle any arbitrary battery pack, we're recycling a known battery pack. So we can be really precise about the recycling.
Recycling is really awesome because most people don't think about this, but a lithium battery, when we build it, and even if you have to use it for 15 or 20 years, at the end of that time, all of the materials that we built into the battery are still in there. None of them have been dispersed in the environment, didn't burn any of them. All the metals, all of the interesting materials are still there. And today, when we make a new battery, materials are the most expensive part of that whole process. So if we can get that same batch of materials back into the factory for almost no cost, the cost of transporting it there, it's a chance to reduce the whole materials budget on that new cell massively. So that's kind of what the future holds for recycling.
Where do you get the lithium from?
And should note also that when the Gigafactory is fully operational, it will be also completely operating on sustainable energy. So we're using geothermal energy, or geothermal for climate control, and then wind, which obviously has supported from other places, and then solar on the roof. And the combination of wind, geothermal, and solar will completely power the Gigafactory. Yeah, so the question is like, what about putting plants in other parts of the world? It's definitely going to make sense to have at least a Gigafactory in every continent. Because otherwise the logistics cost and the energy taken to transport cars halfway around the world is quite high. So we'll kind of reach saturation here, and then we're going to establish a factory in Europe and a factory in Asia, in China, and perhaps in other parts of Asia as well. So I think it's going to make a lot of sense to localize the production to the demand. I'm sure you'd like to. Yeah, so 1% of the output is likely to be for cars versus for stationary storage batteries. In the beginning, I think it's probably going to be on the order of like roughly a third stationary storage, something like that, for 30-35%. But over time, I think probably it will roughly equalize. There will be roughly about as much as many batteries for stationary storage as there are for cars. And if you do this sort of really overarching math of like what's needed at a very high level to transition the world to a sustainable energy scenario, that about works out. You need about as much battery capacity in cars as you do in stationary storage. I encourage people to look at the NRL numbers and some of the
I'll take a lot of three.
Mostly so well. I'm pretty happy with how it's going. I'm really excited by the approach that the Tesla engineering team is taking to production. I think people are really taking it to heart within Tesla that it's actually even more important to design the factory than it is to design the product itself. This is extremely important for making an affordable, high-quality car in volume. So my parents are really, really optimistic about it. We completed the design a couple weeks ago. So it's usually as we do more testing, there's some tweaks required, but we all benefit from a lot of experience, like a lot of SMX, so I'm feeling very good about it.
There's some really cool innovations. I can't talk about all the stuff inside of it, but it is definitely a third generation of a lot of the components and a lot of the systems that we designed originally for Roadster and then all S and X. So it's come a long way.
Can you talk about lithium?
When
do you present?
I think it's been going for a while.
When do you present for two?
Yeah, I'm from Norway.
Oh, hey, Norway.
Chips
for recycling. All forms of terrestrial transport will go electric. I don't currently anticipate Tesla doing ships, but if someone else doesn't do ships, then we will do ships. Anything and basically floats away. But lithium is a metal and does not float away. So there's an enormous amount of lithium. Almost any salty solution, there's some amount of lithium. So most of lithium in the ocean, any kind of dry lake bed, where it was a salt lake that dried long ago, there will be enormous amounts of lithium. So the actual amount of lithium in the world is far in excess of what's needed for electrification and transport. Lithium only constitutes about 2% of the battery. But it's called lithium ion, but it's sort of the active ingredient, but it's only about 2% of the battery.
So there's plenty of lithium to convert every car in the world to electric. You know, that won't be a constraint at all. And even after that summer, you can start recycling it. So we'll keep using lithium. It's not like, you know, oil or something like that. I've heard a lot of those comparisons like heat lithium, which is kind of nonsense. Once you build this new electric car, you don't need any more of it. It's just, you can just keep reusing it and processing it forever.
Forklift batteries.
How about forklift batteries?
Forklift batteries, well, we do need to focus. So we won't be doing forklift batteries in the short term because it's just, we need to kind of stay focused on the Model 3 particularly in the short term.
Yep.
And then probably a compact SUV is the next priority. Very interesting concept for creating kind of like a minibus on the Model X platform.
Yeah.
And it's actually quite surprising how many people you can get on Model X if you make it sort of look a bit like a little bus.
But
focus is critical because there's so many things that could be done, but if we don't focus, then it puts risk that we won't get anything done.
That's the story, guys.
Sort of spread the message, and you know, that's like, I mean, I don't know if you guys think about the war games, but the crazy thing is, like, a lot of people out there don't, a bunch online, there's a non-stop propaganda campaign from fossil fuel industry, because you kind of, I mean, they're defending themselves, so it's kind of what you expect, but it's non-stop, and they have, like 1,000 times more money than we do, so this revolution is going to come from the people. I think it's going to get real money with the nearest election and all that.
Smile, cheese.